The big picture. The collarbone is a weak link in our skeletal system and breaks quite easily. One-wheelers especially have a higher chance of clavicular fracture than e-boarders and electric unicyclers. Why is this so common? For one thing, the inherent sideways stance when riding. That stance results in one shoulder in the forward direction. In fact, it is that same forward side that results in clavicular fracture when the rider falls. Number two, when the one wheel tilts forward in a crash, it is that tilting or catapulting forward that decreases the reaction time for the rider to prepare for the fall, as well as decrease the chance that the one-wheel rider will be able to regain his footing since the catapulting tilt has thrown off his balance further. Number three, most one-wheelers have taken on this one wheel at usually middle to later age in their lives. The reaction times and proprioceptive ability skills are just not as sharp as they used to be. Proprioception is the ability to know where one's body and extremities are relative to our surroundings without looking. This is critical for proper balance and motor control. We have muscle spindles and Golgi tendon organs in our muscle that's continually sending sensory messages to our brain regarding how our muscles are flexing and stretching. This helps us determine our body position relative to our surroundings. For example, we can tell that our legs and feet are correctly positioned on the pedals or board without looking. We are constantly making minor body adjustments in order to maintain our balance when we ride based on our proprioceptive ability. In addition, as one ages, our bone density also decreases, hence more likely to fracture in a crash. As a side note, I started the electric unicycle addiction when I was 49 years old. Most electric unicyclers and one-wheelers are in their 40, 50, and 60-year-old range. The side stance in one-wheel riding is just one fall away from putting massive stress on the same side of the shoulder that falls to the ground. Most clavicle injuries have shown that clavicle fracture is more likely to occur when the rider falls on their same side shoulder than versus when the arm is outstretched or from a direct blow. The electric unicycler, whose stance is front forward, has a higher chance of having a faceplant with associated massive road rash, broken teeth and nose, and concussion. The forearms and wrists are also vulnerable with higher predisposition to forearm road rash and wrist fracture. I must add, the electric unicycler can also have a clavicular fracture in situations such as a pedal clip, and the rider gets spun around and then lands on his side. So, to get back to the main question, why is the clavicle such a fragile bone to fracture in a fall? Did Mother Nature intend for the clavicle to break, or is it just an error in nature? Let's take a closer look at the clavicle. When stood on its side, it looks like a poor piece of supporting structure. Look how unstraight it looks. It certainly would not be good at sustaining weight. Unlike a supporting structure for a building where the beam is straight, this unstraight, curvy shape makes it weak and vulnerable to a stress fracture. We have to stop looking at the clavicle structure as a mistake, but instead as a necessary adaptation. As an analogy, let's use the 1965 Ford Mustang that had a built-in design defect. Its steering column was a long pointy steel rod with a steering wheel on one end, aiming in the general vicinity of your heart. Head-on collisions could have been quite fatal, especially for the driver. Later models came up with a safer solution. They built in an inherent weakness. In a collision, It breaks apart and folds up rather than spearing straight back. All modern cars now have safer collapsible steering shafts of some sort. Shown below is what modern collapsible steering shafts look like. And again, Mother Nature's collapsible collarbone. The natural question is, why? In the chain of evolution, we humans are pretty weak creatures compared to others out there in the fight for survival chain. We did not have big claws, powerful teeth, or long horns, or powerful muscles to fend off predators. We could have easily become as extinct as dinosaurs. What we did have as a great advantage was the biggest brain relative to size out of all the mammals. In addition, our species eventually gained the ability to walk upright. These two properties made us successful as protectors, hunters, and foragers of our people. Unfortunately, having a big brain and being able to walk upright came at a cost. With our small feet and big head being balanced upright on our upright vertebrae and long neck spine, it is basically a balancing act in getting from one place to another. Walking and running is basically an accident waiting to happen. As a result, falling down is a common accident, whether due to being distracted, clumsy, or none of the above. When you fall on your side or shoulder, something has to give. To prevent worse things from happening, the collarbone is a collapsible bone similar to the steering wheel rod. So this is why humans break the clavicle so easily. It prevents your neck from breaking. If you are not lucky enough to have a fracture of your clavicle, you might have died.
Orthopedic surgeon, Todd Ryan, specialist in sports medicine. Dr. Ryan, so under what kind of conditions, what kind of clavicular fractures will you need to have clavicular surgery?
Well, the indications for clavicle surgery have changed a bit since the past 10, 15 years. Originally, it was only severely displaced fractures or ultra elite athletes, but nowadays, the indications are if there's more than 100% displacement of the fracture and greater than 2 centimeters of shortening. The other indication in all cases, if the fracture is going to particularly injure the skin, then surgical intervention is recommended.
How about more conservative measures? What are the indications for not having surgery then?
Indications for not having surgery is medical condition, as always, sometimes. Degree of displacement, desired activity levels, and just alignment of the fracture. And conservative measures, sling. There are figure of eight braces, but they are a bit of a torture device.
Okay. What kind of complications can you expect postoperatively with clavicular fracture?
As with anything, infections possible, but pretty low incidence. The one thing is there is a pectoral sensory nerve that if you don't dissect it out and isolate it, you can end up with numbness in the anterior chest wall. You do end up with numbness around the incision, but that's just any time with an incision. Non-union is pretty unlikely, and hardware failure is very uncommon.
Okay, so let's say that it's conservative measures are done. How soon can one go back to bicycling or any kind of activity that they're usually used to that caused the accident?
I would say bicycling, you could probably go back at around 3 months on the long, maybe at 2 months if you're doing well enough, but as far as for other heavier activities, I generally recommend about 6 months at least, okay, just to restore motion and strength.
All right. Well, thank you very much, Dr. Ryan. I do appreciate you taking the time to answer these questions. I'm sure the writers watching this will truly appreciate it.
You're welcome.
Thank you so much. Take care.
Thank you.
Hope you enjoyed this video. If you did, please like and subscribe, as it would really help my channel. Thanks for watching, and until next time.